your independence wasn't allowed. Only good for cooking and cleaning up the house. Only known for being a housewife wearing gowns. Went from dependent to the most independent girl around. You discipline with your diligence, I respect that. Equal rights for the sexes, we all accept that. Random guys with her number, she might expect that. But if he's not on his grind, she might reject that. It takes a false day to fall asleep. Got what it takes, they the boss, baby. Yeah, bro, sexy, that's the boss, baby. Know how to carry a sexy, you a boss, baby. Do whatever to exist, you a boss, baby. You gotta practice what you preach, you a boss, baby.
Hello, everyone, and I want to thank you for tuning in to Boss Lady News. You know you can catch me every Friday at 6 p.m. Also, feel free to go to the website, bossladynews.com. If you haven't noticed, I do have an additional chair with me because as we discuss news going forward, I'd actually like you to hear more statistical and factual information. And Miss Tayla Andre from Big Cities Wake Up with Tayla Andre every Monday through Thursday from 5 to 7 a.m. is going to be joining me for the news. We are also going to have Charles Clemens, which is a candidate for another position. I'm going to go ahead and let him explain that to you. And then we're going to take a media moment, and I'm going to have you all go ahead and listen to some of the videos that I'm posting on my Facebook. So, with no further ado, as we always do, we're going to go ahead and get into some news. Tayla, why don't you come on out here? How are you?
How are you?
I'm so excited. This is To New Beginnings 2016.
How are you?
I am good. How have you been?
I'm amazing. You said Monday through Thursday, so I think you'd want to cut out Freaky Friday. Is that what you're trying to do?
So it's the Freaky Monday? Friday is not for you 5 p.m. or 6 p.m. people.
No, Freaky Friday is actually the best.
Nice. My favorite. That's when they really, really get to go in and find out what people like to do personally. So we want to discuss news. Mm-hmm. And you've always got some of the best topics. I'm sometimes on like social media tagging you to stuff that I'm finding out. And you're like, yeah, I talked about that the other day. So I figured to go ahead and actually have you come on and discuss news with me.
Well, and I thank you for that opportunity. One of the things that I pride myself is discussing topics that mainstream media neglects. Mm-hmm. And, you know, we have some of the best topics and they are very unorthodox, very unorthodox,
absolutely,
leading to universal consciousness.
But yes, yes. And we are all trending in the direction of consciousness. And that's why it's such an opportunity for me to really start including other people and other producers and other hosts and other entertainers out there onto my show, too, because knowledge is power and we've all got it. And we all need to share it, I think, a little more often with the young people, too.
Absolutely.
Yes. So what do you have for me? What's one of the topics that you wanted to bring to the table?
Lord have mercy.
It's time to go in.
So one of the things that I wanted to discuss was the gas flaring. We had the gas leak in Southern California. So I love facts. I love statistics. So it wasn't until November that anyone knew how much methane was actually spewing into the atmosphere. So this Porter Ranch is 25 miles away from Los Angeles.
Wow.
Every day, over 100,000 pounds are spewing into the air. These wells are over 60 years old. There's 111 of these wells. Mm-hmm. And they have emitted 82,000 metric tons of methane.
What does that mean?
Okay,
to
I knew you were going
to
ask me that.
Yes.
So that means that is the equivalent to 111 million vehicles on the road at one time.
Wow.
And one of the things that's so important to me, I feel, is that, you know, this is a huge issue that we really need to tackle head on. But for the past 15 years, Shell Corporation has been flaring in the Niger Delta. And let me get the facts straight, because they just paid residents of the Niger Delta equivalent to $84 million, which is nothing, when they were in 2012 named the most profitable company in the world.
And this is Shell.
This is Shell, yeah.
So as you all are going and getting your gas, I want you to factor in where you're getting your gas from and who you're actually supporting.
Absolutely.
Yes.
So out of that 84 million that they were forced, because it was awarded to them, they went ahead and sued Shell, and Shell had to shell out $84 million. But in 2012, they net $467 billion.
Wow.
$467 billion.
And we all question ourselves, where are we getting our gas from? One of the topics that I had found out about just recently, actually, and I'm going to jump to exactly today, mm-hmm. I was reading in the Bay State Banner that there's a growing increase in young students that are now homeless. Mm. So not only is the Boston Public mm-hmm. School going to be losing funding, which means certain programs, we all know that a lot of programs are already taken out of our Boston Public Schools.
Yes.
However, now there's this issue of homelessness amongst the teenagers, mm-hmm. whether it's from parents saying, okay, you're 17, you're 18, you're grown, get out, mm-hmm. or if it's the families themselves that are unable to sustain housing and are living out of their cars.
So I actually have a connection to this because a friend of mine runs an organization that heads 15 other organizations. And one of the things that she tells me about is the fact that a lot of these young people that are homeless are because they don't have anybody else to turn to. Mm. So a lot of them are foreign born, who are sent over with an auntie or uncle, somebody has passed away, somebody mm-hmm. you know, can no longer take care of them. So this is definitely a growing problem. One of the things that I want to make mention is that BPS has a $1,315,500,000 budget.
Yeah.
78% of that budget goes into the pockets of adults, mm-hmm. with 65% as salaries, mm-hmm. and 13% as pensions and benefits. 78% of that $1,315,500,000. Nobody questions that? Nobody...
Where the money's
yeah,
going.
Yeah, where is the money
going?
And
how it's being spent. And just for you all, and I think it was incredible that you guys can go to BossLadyNews.com and you can go to Boss Lady News on Facebook. And I actually have footage of Taylor sitting down at City Hall and talking with the members of Congress, right? The members of City Hall, and discussing this budget that I feel like they really, even after you brought up the numbers, pushed it over to the side.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
So, and our kids are not stupid.
Not at all. So out of that number, and I keep repeating it because I need people to be mindful, mm-hmm. $1,315,500,000, 1% of that, 1%, it's actually less than 1%, it's $8 million, is actually spent on supplies.
And they're taking from the Boston Public School System and from our kids. What's another topic that you have in there for us?
Okay, so recently David Bowie died.
Yes.
All right, so heart and soul, Kanye West tweeted about him. Everyone's, you know, he's such a royal.
What was me?
Man. Yeah.
I'm sorry, it's quite a few people dying, celebs dying, but.
So one of the things that nobody ever talks about when they discuss David Bowie is the fact that he was one of the many artists during the 70s that were sleeping with teenagers.
Oh, wow.
And it was widely, no, everybody knew, it was popular. Mm-hmm. They were called baby groupies. And they were anywhere between the ages of 13 and 16, and they were sleeping with grown men, and they were dressed in sexy attire, and mm-hmm. there was even magazines that did spreads on them, mm-hmm. and David Bowie.
And now we would call that child pornography, and
absolutely.
People would be arrested for it.
Absolutely.
Bill Cosby. I just wanted to make sure we threw this these conversations in together.
It's more than just Bill Cosby. We have to. So when you go to church on Sunday and they're talking about Ephesians or Genesis, what is one of the things that they do? They set the time. This is what it looked like. This is what the atmosphere was. This is what the people were doing. This is what the kingdom was like.
Mm-hmm.
The atmosphere. And it just, when you think about that atmosphere, and then you think about what David Bowie did, and then what Bill Cosby has done.
Mm-hmm. It was the times.
It was the times.
And we really need to consider that when we're persecuting people in this day and age. And I want to say that for our young people also. Mm-hmm. We're going to cut to a brief PSA. There's never enough time whenever we get to talk. But Taylor is going to be on with us for the news so that we can bring up these discussions and bring real facts to you all. Mm. So you're tuned into Boss Lady News, and we'll be right back.
Don't look at me.
Your hair's a bit frizzy today.
Aww.
Such a dork.
Loser.
Here, let me help you with that. Oops.
Every day, kids witness bullying.
Oh, look! Your crush is looking at you.
Poor you.
They want to help, but don't know how.
See, no one here is going to help you, because no one
Teach your kids how to be more than a bystander. Visit stopbullying.gov.
Hi. May I please have an application? Thank you.
Skip the drama. Get your diploma.
Okay.
Take that first step towards a better future. Find free adult education classes at finishyourdiploma.org.
Everyone, and thank you for staying tuned to Boss Lady News. I hope you're having a wonderful day. Please make sure you go to the website, bossladynews.com. Also, if you know of any people, events, situations, or anything you think I should know about, feel free to email me, bossladynews@gmail.com. Next, we're going to be speaking with Charles Clemens from our community, from our neighborhood, and you all know him very well from Touch FM. Touch 106.1 FM, I wanted to make sure I said that correctly, as well as Touch TV now. Brother Charles, why don't you come on out here? Hi,
peace
how
and
are
blessings.
You?
Blacknificent.
Have a seat, I love that, you always say that, blacknificent. So thank you for coming on again.
Yes ma'am.
And I wanted the audience, of course, to get a chance to follow up. I wanted to get a chance to follow up. I know you stay super busy, and you're always going to the plethora of the meetings and conferences that are being held throughout the area, and you're always bringing wonderful information to the people. So what have you been up to lately?
Well, there was the proposed liquor store in beautiful Uptown Grove Hall at 438. 440 Blue Hill Avenue, right in between Stanwood Street and the entrance of the Mecca Mall, where we had a family that lived in Woburn who wanted to open up a liquor store in beautiful Uptown Grove Hall because they see the gentrification coming to our community, and they wanted to be above ahead of the curve and provide some exotic wine tasting and beer tasting with some cheese and crackers. And one thing we don't need is another liquor store in our community.
Absolutely.
We need training facilities, educational facilities. We need conflict resolution centers, and you know, it just goes on and on.
Yeah.
And recently, Governor Deval, I still love my Deval factor.
I know.
Governor Charlie Baker was in Roxbury.
He's still getting used to it. That's why. He's got to be amongst the people of color, the black people here, a lot more.
And at 2201 Washington Street in Roxbury, they just put together this urban agenda where they're going to train and offer over 100 jobs in the hospitality industry. And the jobs are going to start at $19 an hour. So I'm
When is this supposed to start?
Well,
it's
in the working right now.
Okay.
They just had the ribbon cutting the other day.
Okay.
And
so it is finalized and confirmed.
Right. It's a partnership with Madison Park Development, along with Best Corp and the Commonwealth of Massachusetts.
That's a really good. That's a wonderful.
Yeah.
Wow. I kind of want to bounce back to the owners or potential wanted to be owners of the liquor store. And you mentioned that they were from Woburn.
Yes.
So I guess one of my questions is, for people who are outside of the city wanting to purchase space and be retailers or vendors, are the people in the community allowed to kind of know what's coming in and when it's coming in and what's proposed to take over certain buildings and certain space?
Well, that's a good question. And what I would say is become part of a neighborhood association.
Okay.
With the neighborhood association, you will stay ahead of some of the information that's going on. But also, when it comes to your elected officials, especially on the local level, city council, you have your district city councils, then you have your city councils at large, mm-hmm. create a relationship with them so that you can stay in the loop of what's going on down at City Hall.
Okay. And Charlie Baker, our new governor, Charlie Baker, made his way into Roxbury the other night, matter of fact. I was invited to the 12th Baptist Church, my first time being there. Thank you, Ms. Nelson, for the invitation.
Yes.
Okay.
And he was there and, you know, enjoying the music, enjoying the atmosphere. And one of the things that I thought was interesting was there wasn't very much media of, like, him being there. And I thought that was interesting because anything that political people are doing, there's typically a lot of media.
Yeah, and that's why it's so important for us to have our own media, mm-hmm. whether it's radio, television, or print, so that we can get the word out. It seems that only time that there is this media frenzy mm-hmm. is when there's something negative going on in
Absolutely.
Our community.
Yes, yes. Very good that you brought that point up. We're going to cut to a brief PSA.
Okay.
And when we come back, we want to find out more about what you're doing lately. And I've got some legislature questions that we should all know about. And so we will be right back after this brief break.
If you store your guns properly.
So not just anyone can get to them.
I'll feel safer when I'm playing outside.
Safer when walking home.
I won't have to tell so many family members. I'm sorry.
I won't hear as many scary stories.
Or scary news reports.
I won't have to hold someone's hand and shout you're gonna make it.
And I won't have to tell my kids this isn't a drill.
Please.
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 Do it for us.
For us.
Do it for us.
Your family, friends, and neighbors are all counting on you. Never let your gun get into the wrong hands. If you own a firearm and are not using it, please be responsible and be sure that it's stored in a safe place. Remember, always lock it up. For more information on firearm storage safety, visit ncpc.org.
Hi, may I please have an application? Thank you.
Skip the drama. Get your diploma.
Okay.
Take that first step towards a better future. Find free adult education classes at finishyourdiploma.org.
Hello, everyone, and thank you for staying tuned to Boss Lady News. We are right now talking with Brother Charles Clemens, and I guess people should also know why you prefer to be called Brother Charles Clemens. And there's Muhammad at the end now.
Yes.
You're constantly changing your Facebook names. So explain that briefly to us.
Well, brother, because I want people to look at me as your brother first. Mm-hmm. Even though I was a correctional officer, a Boston police officer, an entrepreneur, radio personality, I want to be your brother first. So when I walked to beat in beautiful Uptown Grove Hall, they called me Brother Charles. They did not call me Officer Clemens.
Okay.
When I was a CO or correctional officer at Deer Island, they called me Brother Charles. They didn't call me CO Clemens.
Okay.
So brother is real personal.
I like that. And I, you know, for other reasons, I thought maybe it was just, hey, it's my brother, it's my bro, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
But it's good to know that you want to be relatable to
That's
the community.
Right.
So yes, while I was at this church, 12 Baptist Church, our new governor, Charlie Baker, was there. Mind you, I still have yet to meet Marty Walsh or see him out in Roxbury, in Dorchester, but I'd like that to happen also. But I also saw people like Sandra Chang Diaz, mm-hmm. and I don't actually know who she is or what she does.
Well, her title would be State Senator Sonia Chang Diaz, as opposed to Senator Sonia Chang Diaz. You have your different levels of government. You have your local level, which would be the city of Boston. Your mayor is like the CEO, and then you have your city councilors. You have four city councilors at large, and then you have your district city councilors.
Okay.
Then we go to the next level, which would be the state.
Okay.
And your CEO of the state
would be
the governor.
Okay.
Right.
Okay.
So the governor's like the mayor, mm-hmm. but on the state level.
Okay.
And then you have your houses. You have your state house, not the state house, but you have your state senators, and then you have your House of Representatives.
Okay.
And so there's the two tiers there, which comes together in, you know, in the House of Representatives. You know, they try to push forward laws, and then it goes over to the Senate, and then they say yes, and then it goes to the governor for the governor to sign off on it.
Okay.
Which is the same, that's the same as on the federal level. On the federal level, the CEO is the president.
Okay, yes.
And then you have your senators and your congressmen or congresswomen. Those are your different houses, your balance
okay.
that you have there. So it starts off in Congress, which is the whole House,
mm-hmm.
but then broken up in the House. You have your reps, and then you have your senators.
So how important is it that people really do get out there and vote? Because mm-hmm. one of my arguments with many of my friends is that the president hasn't done anything for black people, as if they don't understand that the president has to rule an entire land mm-hmm. and really has to kind of cater to a lot of people.
Mm-hmm.
But if there are not people within these houses that are for what he wants to do, then it makes it that much more difficult for him to do it.
That's true. However, when you vote, you are saying that you are supporting this individual to represent you.
Okay.
Now, when you vote for that individual and they get into that seat, now you have to hold them accountable. You know what you want them to do for you, but how is that going to happen?
Mm-hmm.
It's going to happen by you staying in contact with that person and saying, hey, this is what we need, but you can't be just one person. It has to be, you know, a group of people.
The masses.
So that's why it's so important for, if you have an agenda, to, you know, rally the troops up to say, hey, listen, this is the issues that we want. Now let's go to the local level.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you want a street sign on your street, the mm-hmm. corner of your street. Well, what you do is you get a petition with like-minded people on your street, then you go to your district city councilor, but not just your district city councilor, your citywide city councilors. So you have five that represent you and say, hey, this is what we need. You know, cars are flying down the street and possibly hitting people, so we want a stop sign there. Or we want to put speed bumps
mm-hmm.
on our street.
Mm-hmm.
This is what I voted for you to
or
represent
crosswalks.
Me. There it goes.
Okay. So, Tito Jackson, I saw you on social media and you told me to email your office about having a crosswalk on Warren Street for the kids that are crossing the bus and going to City on a Hill. I've sent that out there and now I'm officially asking you from the TV show now. They need a crosswalk across Warren Street where the bus lets off and the kids walk over to City on a Hill, because Warren turns into Walnut. And then there's a curve where the bus lets the kids off, and the kids are always crossing the street, adults, carriages even. There should be a crosswalk there. It might not get there until full gentrification has happened, and other people are requesting it. However,
well, let's take it to another level. You call City Hall at 617-635-4000,
mm-hmm.
and you ask to speak to City Councilor District City Councilor Tito Jackson, and then voice your concerns. But you don't stop there, because now we have the city councilors at large, City Councilor Ayanna Presley, City
mm-hmm.
Councilor Michelle Wu, City Councilor Michael Flaherty, and City Councilor Anissa. So they represent you also.
Mm-hmm.
So now you bring that to them, all those issues to them also. Now you have five fighting for you to get what you
to
want.
To get that.
And
then
not just you, the
that,
rest of the community makes the phone calls.
Absolutely. And speaking of that, I know you are meant to be in specific positions. However, you got to get your foot in the door. And I know right now you are running for another position.
Well, it's the Ward 12
mm-hmm.
Democratic Committee Chairperson. And it's strictly volunteer.
Mm-hmm.
You don't get paid for anything like this. However, you get to represent district Ward 12.
Ward 12.
And Ward 12 would be, say if you was in Grove Hall and you went down Blue Hill Avenue, everything on your left-hand side, mm-hmm. until you get close to Winthrop or Moreland Street, take that left, and then start heading up Walnut. And so that little pocket right there, I would love to represent and be the voice of our community to make sure that we have a voice inside this ward and make sure the issues and the concerns, our issues and concerns are heard.
Are met, absolutely.
So on March the 1st, we vote.
On March the 1st, we vote.
That's right. We vote for the presidential primaries. This mm-hmm. is the primaries to weed out the all the candidates that you have running for president, but also the different wards, Ward 12, Ward 8, and so on. So my name is the first name on the ballot.
First name on the ballot, and you said, what's that date one more time?
March the 1st.
March the 1st. So everyone, please make sure you are a registered voter. And if you need to become a registered voter, if you don't know, make sure you call City Hall, correct?
Well, you can call me at 617-334-4639 at 617-334-4639 or email me at charlesfordistrict7@gmail.com. And that's the number 7.
Wonderful. We are going to cut to a brief PSA, and when we come back, I wanted to invite you all to take a look at my Facebook page and some of the things that I enjoy posting. And this particular video is from a producer who created a clip because he is an activist, and there are a lot more people in the entertainment industry that I believe should be doing things like this. So.
We taught him how to hit a baseball. How to hit a receiver. The strike zone. The net. You taught him how to hit the upper corner. You even taught him how to hit the open man. But how much time have you spent teaching him what not to hit?
Get caught buzz driving, and you could do some hard time.
Craig, knock it off.
Sorry, Mom.
It could cost you around $10,000 in fines, legal fees, and increased insurance rates. And that could set you back a few years. Buzzed, busted, and broke. Because buzz driving is drunk driving.
When I was in foster care, I never knew when I would have to move. So I always had my suitcase ready to go. Then one day, I was adopted. My new parents opened their hearts and home to me. My parents cook my favorite breakfast for me every morning. My parents take me on trips I never thought I would go on. They gave me a home and an even better reason to use that suitcase. My parents aren't perfect, but they're perfect for me.
I hope you all had a great day today. I know I did, and I hope you enjoyed my guest, Miss Taylor Andre from Big City 101.3. Also, wakeupwithtaylorandre.com. You can find out about more in-depth news from her. Brother Charles Clemens running for District 12 representative, and you can find out more definitely by contacting him. The number is always available. And like I said, I wanted you all to get a chance to meet a producer-director that created a short clip, and he'll be able to explain the whole thing to you. The clip, you will follow that later and watch it. However, there are many entertainers, rappers, musicians, singers, artists, actors, directors, producers, such as Spike Lee even, who have always been great activists in the community, not just for black people, but for equality and people understanding that there needs to be a better balance. So I hope you all enjoy this clip. It, again, is on Boss Lady News Facebook page.
The situation happened with Ferguson, and I was moved and compelled to act in some way, and I feel as though film is my platform. So I connected with a few friends, and we decided to put something together that could inspire empathy, because the only thing worse than these young brothers being killed is the fact that people seem indifferent to their lives. So, we put it together in a matter of weeks. We reached out to J. Cole. He gave us a song, and I wanted to start a conversation not just about, all lives matter in the context of a hashtag and a buzzword, but really trying to figure out where do we need to get to the place, what place do we need to get to where America is really standing up to its ideals. And so this is basically a jump off point to talk about the things that we're dealing with in this society as we live in it right now.
And Nate, the short was just, it's a short film, about 15 minutes.
Yeah.
It's on YouTube. I invite all of our viewers to see it, because I will tell you, I was stunned when I saw it in my office today.
And by the twist in it, I didn't know where you were going, and then I got it, and I just felt it, and
right.
It was powerful.
It was extremely powerful, and the film is a lot about, I think, subconscious bias, perhaps, and how men, young black men and young white men, encounter police officers. Can you tell us a little bit about your personal experience with that? What made you write about that in this film?
Well, the reality and the root of all of what we're seeing in America right now, in my opinion, is white supremacy. It seems to be a word no one wants to talk about, no one wants to say, because of its connections, obviously, through the genocide, to the genocide of the Jewish community. But white supremacy is a definition of racism. We like to talk about racism in terms of racial hates and hoods and bombing houses in the South, in Mississippi, or whatever. That seems convenient, but the reality is the first two definitions of racism are white supremacy and systemic racism, and that is what we're dealing with. So with this film, what I wanted to bring to light is how a good man, a good police officer, someone that loved his family, someone that did not brutalize his children, someone that before he does what he does, you would think, that's a cop I would want in my community, he goes out and he is susceptible to a system that is racist and that is a part of a disparity that affects young black people more than anyone else.
Well, there's certainly, you know, when you talk about white supremacy, though, there's a recognition by you, I'm sure, that there are extremely positive and motivated and even-keeled people in white America who don't mean African Americans harm in any way. I mean, would you agree with that notion? You're not talking about everybody, are you?
Listen, black empowerment doesn't mean white hate. You know, white supremacy is something that affects all of us. You know, I remember being young and seeing images of Africa and seeing, you know, young kids with pot bellies and flies walking on their eyes. And I felt a certain way about my blackness through that context. It's all programming. We're all conditioned.
But you didn't let that define you, though, Nate, did you? In other words, you went on to do great things. And while there may be elements of America who have, you know, who don't have the best of intentions, it's not something we could say is really all America, can we?
Well, guess what? You're the exception to the rule. I'm the exception to the rule. The Yale brothers that were there are the exception to the rule. We're not the rule. We should not be seen as the barometer. You know, our President Obama is not the barometer. He's an exception, because for every one of us, there's so many dying. There's so many, you know, being dealt, you know, a part of the prison industrial complex, you know, a part of a broken education systems. What we're dealing with is real. And as long as we're looking to the exception to let us know where we are as a country, we're never going to change.
And you mentioned earlier, you know, the term white supremacy. So many people would consider that to be an extreme view. Do you consider yourself an extremist?
Absolutely not. It's the definition. If you go and look up the racism in the definition, it says white supremacy, and then it says institutional or systemic racism, and then it says racial hate. The reality is this. Instead of us taking this and saying, all right, is this where we are? Are we in a society that elevates one race above the other? You know, we talk about a racial divide. It's not so much a racial divide as it is a racial hierarchy. The reality is black lives are just don't carry the same value. And that's evident in the lack of consequences we're seeing across the nation with young men being killed and young women being
killed. But your life has value, and our lives have value, and everybody has an opportunity, do they not, to advance themselves. In other words, you know, you have the views that you have, and we respect
really
all views here. Go ahead.
Right.
But at the end of the day,
you said everyone has the, okay, go ahead.
I'm sorry.
Go ahead. No, go ahead. I'm sorry.
No, Nate, please.
No. He said, doesn't everyone have a choice? Doesn't everyone have the right? The reality is, who I am right now as an activist, artist, my trajectory could be cut short at any moment by a poorly conditioned whether it be an officer or citizen, that their knee-jerk reaction is to pull the trigger and kill me. Maybe I can, before I get killed, yell, hey, I'm an actor, don't shoot me, I'm not like everyone else. Maybe that would help me. But in reality, we don't often get that chance.
Nat, isn't that unfair to the police? I've known Pat Brosnan for a long time. I've done work with Pat Brosnan. He's here on set. I want him to address that, because certainly, that, you know, we could argue that there's aggressive policing in African-American communities.
We're not saying the same thing.
But what are we saying? I mean, your life can change, our lives can change, but we had Yale students here who are making a difference, who are African-American
men. But what makes Yale, right, but what makes Yale different from Howard, or makes Yale different from any other school? The reality is, if you have black skin or you have brown skin in this country, you are at a disadvantage when it comes to your life being valued.
You could be at a disadvantage, but at the end of the day, it's up to us, right? It's up to the individual, wherever you go. You could go to Howard, you could go to Yale, you could go to Brock, but you could go to any college you want to, but we have a choice to move forward, to empower ourselves, to take responsibility, and not just say white supremacy, the white man's holding us down, there's nothing we can do. Everyone has an individual choice.
But guess what? Whether you know it or not, you are an exception to the rule. Even though you may not accept that, but for every one of you that made it to where you are in journalism even, there's so many that are on the other end of that disparity that haven't made it to where you are. I know that. You asked me about myself personally. I'm from Norfolk, Virginia. I come from a project called Tidewater Park, right? I'm one of the very few that can stand in front of you and say I've had success in my life, whether it be in the arts, whether it be financial or whatever. But when I go back and see, I don't see a bunch of people with a choice to pull themselves up by the bootstraps, that have equal employment opportunities, that have equal education opportunities, that aren't being touched by the criminal justice system in a negative way almost every day of their lives.
Nat, just now, one thing, and I want to spin over to Pat, because I want Pat to address this. I grew up in the Bronx.
Sure.
I was raised in the Bronx. I wasn't raised with privilege. Mm-hmm. I ran around with people in my neighborhood from the community, and the reality is mm-hmm. I had choices when I was growing up with who to hang out with, who not to hang out with, what to do, what not to do, and so, you know, I was susceptible to the same experiences.
But Joey, I think to Nate's point, the bottom line is the statistics do point out that the race, the color of your skin, does matter.
Absolutely.
It does matter. And in a sense, when you look at least at the statistics between when you have confrontations between police and black men, by and large, black men end up at the short end of the stick. And I think, Pat Brosnan, I want to bring you in because you are a former NYPD detective. The stats clearly show that black men are at a much higher rate killed by white police officers than white victims.
Well, you know, Sonny, that's an easy one for me to counter with other incontrovertible facts as it relates to statistics. What I'd rather do is, if you don't mind, I'd like to address two things. First of all, now I know why I like Joey. I also was born and raised in the Bronx.
Lived I was, too. 34 I'm from the South Bronx.
We'll talk about that separately. But so now I kind of get it. But the thing is, you know, Nate's assessment and his fear of a knee-jerk reaction by a police officer of shooting him for no reason is not based in fact. And again, I'm not going to mire this conversation. Well, I'll tell you why. Because if you look right now, well, allow me, Nate. If you look at the Garner, the facts as it relates to the Garner decision in the grand jury, and the facts as it relates to the Michael Brown decision in the grand jury, what drives that whole decision-making process was two words. It's a noun, it's an adjective. It's bad decisions. They made bad decisions. And what the decisions were, Sonny, were they took an unfolding situation with a police officer and they failed to comply with a lawful order and a lawful arrest. And what happened was it became resisting arrest. So now you have two nouns. You have larceny. That wasn't a strong-arm robbery. With Brown, that was a low-level robbery. It was a larceny. He would have been out. And Lucy's, that would have been a fine.
Aren't you blaming the victim, though? Do the officers not have any place here? Are you telling me and our viewers and everyone here that race did not play a part at all in some of the decisions perhaps that the officers were making? Well, the escalation of force that we saw that we didn't have to, that we didn't have to see?
Absolutely.
I'm being wrapped in my ear, but I think this is so important.
Okay.
You must concede, Pat, that there are white kids that make the same kinds of mistakes that Michael Brown made, same kinds of mistakes that Eric Garner made, but they are still alive.
I can't concede on that, Sonny, without looking at all the facts. I'll give you this. There's one incontrovertible fact on this. Had they complied, they would have been fined they'd both be alive today. They made this decision. It was a bad decision.
But there are underlying white communities making just as many bad decisions, but that's not where our police choose to enforce the laws. The same laws apply to everyone in the abstract, but in practice, you see police officers enforcing in predominantly minority communities, and that's why we see disproportionately more black people being incarcerated and being ultimately killed in police confrontations.
But Dan, you're taking it in a vacuum. There are whites that are killed by the cops who are in similar situations.
Not as many.
Where they don't comply.
But not as many. Nate Parker.
That's the end of our show today, and I wanted to thank you once again for staying tuned. And I just wanted to give a brief reflection for all the people out there that are a little confused possibly with that conversation. You had Nat Turner that was discussing the inability or lack of opportunities for people that have skin tones very similar to mine or people of color. And then you had the reporter who was saying, we all can make the best decisions that will steer our lives. But for many people of color, that's not possible. It's not always an opportunity for certain jobs to be received or get that acceptance letter because of the color of your skin. There still are quotas that need to be kept, and that's why a lot of people of color are really competing with other people of color to get the same positions that you'll have 7 or 8 non-people of color already be able to receive. So one thing that has been prevalent and apparent to everyone is with opportunity, young people can do a lot. So as long as you're willing to offer that opportunity to anybody, you never know what you're going to get. And I encourage you all to go ahead and open up your minds, open up that box, and be willing to accept and receive more people of color and their potential and their success. All right, you're talking. I'm going to listen. I hope you enjoyed Boss Lady News. I'll see you next time. All right, now, so we're going to go ahead and get into the Q&A here with Jimmy. You guys have a couple questions. Any artists that are out there that haven't had a chance to get onto New England Jams, make sure you email, all right? Not playing around. Right now, the artists that are on this episode 1, part 2 of New England Jams, they got a couple questions for you.
All right.
So, El Queasy, he wanted to know, what is the most effective way to build an audience for a new artist?
For a new artist to build an audience, is the best way to do is go to showcases. I know sometimes you gotta pay for it and stuff, but that's the way you get known, by the A&Rs, and along with that, more than that, the promoters of the place. Because if you're nasty, they're gonna bring you back and pay you to come through. And second of all, in order for you to also get noticed, obviously, social media. That's like the number one thing right now. But, you know, just for presence, for people to see. Like someone like me, you could have millions of views, and I'll check you out. But then I really want to go check you out and see how you do, your draw, your crowd, how your movement is, who you're coming with, who you're rolling with. Are you rolling dolo, or you got a team? You know, all that matters if you have a movement or not, you know?
Absolutely. Many times you'll go to a concert, and you'll find out that there's no audience there for them.
Exactly.
And yeah, they're great on social media, which is the drive.
Because like a lot of people buy stuff on social media so they can be up there. And a lot of people pay to get placement, their music on the radio and stuff for them to be hot. But sometimes they don't even really have fans.
Yeah.
And we see a lot of that happening.
That's true. All right. You guys, make sure you're listening. We've got the next question for you. And this one is coming from Livelette. He is a conscious reggae singer and very much into the actual revolution of what reggae music did, Bob Marley, his whole movement on uniting people, and he in fact is also an educator.
Right.
So he uses his music, which I think is great, to educate people as well. So the question he had was, what are the best sites and avenues for promoting music, and how can one go about getting a video on those sites or channels?
The best avenue for getting the videos out and stuff, and promoting your music on TV and everywhere else, and especially conscious like me. Right now in this era, it's kind of weird. Music has changed. Not a lot of people like conscious music, which is so weird for my era. It's all about conscious. If you say some garbage, people are like, what? Right now, it's just about the hooks and dances, it seems like. For a reggae artist, you know, I met a Junior Reed, so I've seen Junior Reed struggle too because he's a conscious artist. Like, people love when Junior talks about murder this, murder that on hip hop songs, but when he really talks about like One Blood and like the conscious stuff that's out, people kind of fall from it, like the younger cats. So it's a little tricky on the reggae scene compared to the hip hop scene. You know, hip hop scene is kind of like, I think, easier than the reggae scene. Because reggae scene is hard to break in, because if you're not known as a main person in the reggae scene, you're not really going to break into it.
Absolutely.
Compared to the hip-hop scene, you could be a young guy coming out with some money backing you and you're popping. But reggae, you have to get that respect in the game. And for the videos that you want to get into, you know, Hip-Hop DX, well, for reggae artists like Reggaeville, you know, different things. So you don't want to just put your music into, like, anywhere. Like, you know, like MTV.com, BET.com, that's great and everything. You know, especially if you get interviews from like Jack Miller and different things, but more than that is you gotta spend money to get to where you are, and if you're gonna spend money to get your placement on videos for shows, TV shows and stuff, make sure you're putting in the right one. As a reggae artist, you're not gonna put it into Hip Hop DX, because to them, they're gonna be like, okay, that's cool.
Not their crowd.
You wanna put it into your crowd, like Reggae Reflection and stuff. Like, you wanna put it into the sites that's gonna actually touch your crowd. Like, and you know, like Worldstar, you can pay 5 G's, 2 G's, whatever, and get in the front and everything, which you get plenty of views, and that's a very, very good way to start, but you still gotta invest. But once you invest, you gotta get your money together, because you can't just do one video and say, oh, I put all my chips into this, and then your next video comes like 6 months later, or your next single, and then you're already starting fresh. If you look at all these artists that's popping, they're all over the radio because they're paying for the radio, but they're staying relevant. They're coming hits after hits after hits after hits after hits, because the money they make, they're throwing it right back into music. Some artists, with the money they make, they spend it on themselves. Oh, I'm getting a nice whip. Oh, I'm getting all these fly clothes. The real artists, when they make that money, they make that money and flip it right back into their marketing.
Absolutely.
Right back into their next video, their songs, until they keep doing it and doing it until they get bigger shows, and then they can start flossing. But that's the differentiates the big people from the small people, the bigger minds and the small minds, investments and non-investment, long-term, short-term.
Absolutely. And one thing that I want to make sure we do, not on this episode, but maybe on the next one, is talk with you about how musicians can, in fact, invest in other businesses.
Oh, of course. Musicians.
We'll talk about it on the next one.
Okay.
You guys make sure you stay in tune for that. So,
that's huge.
That's huge. Mariah, we actually got a chance to get her question on record.
Okay.
So I'm going to go ahead and let you take a look at her asking the question
awesome.
For you.
Okay. All right. Well, first of all, before you work with someone, do your research. Find out what they're doing, what they're about. Talk to their people around them. You know, make sure they got a good name, they didn't burn anyone. Because streets talk, especially in this game. The industry's really small, so everyone knows each other. So if you mess up, everyone's gonna know about it. If you mess up on a show, you beat someone, everyone's gonna know about it. And that's up to you to deal with that person or whatever, you know, because you're a grown person. But do your research. And second of all, when you work with someone and things aren't going right, don't blame everything on that person, because it's your career. It's not really that person's career. That person's career is to put people on. And they got over 100,000 people reaching out at them. So if they're working with you,
and you being one of them.
Yeah. Let's say I'm working with someone, but someone's giving me a lot of problems. Just little things like, yep. Oh, why not here? Da-da-da-da-da-da-da. That's not really gonna help me to push you. Because I got other guys and other girls that's hungry, that's doing it like, hey, I'm on the newspaper. Hey, I'm on this. Hey, I'm on this.
They push what they are doing.
Something like that I see, that I'm like, oh, I could invest in that. I could throw some money here and there where I know it's going to go somewhere. Compared to someone that's like, I got all the talent in the world. I should be next. I should be blown up. I should be on TV. I should be this. I'm the best. If you are the best in everything, why aren't you there already?
Absolutely.
Right? So there's a difference in that level too. And to find the right people to give things to that's not going to burn you, you can't necessarily say that no one's going to burn you, because everyone has a different meaning of being burned.
That's true.
Like, I could work with someone and I could put my money towards it and actually get this thing moving, but then that person could have another idea where I don't feel comfortable, where I'm like, no, I'm not doing that. That doesn't even seem right. I mean, why would you go that way when the blueprint's right here? So when that happens, and I'm like, damn, I'm just going to waste money and wasting time, then I fall back. Then they could say, I burnt them. Well, I'm pretty sure no one will say that about me yet.
No one's saying that about you.
Not yet. So I got a good day so far. But that's it happens a lot in the industry, because I meet a lot of artists and that I manage and stuff, and they'll be like, oh, my last record label burnt me. My last manager sucked and didn't do anything. And then I look at their BDS, how many spins they're getting. I look at their sound scan, see how many they sold. And then I look at it like, damn, you only sold like 1,000 like units. Like, who's gonna invest in you? Second of all, the label dropped you because you didn't sell enough. They didn't burn you, and they didn't market you because you didn't market yourself. Once you start marketing yourself and get the buzz, the label will get behind it. If you don't have a buzz, the label's not gonna push you, because there's no point unless they have an objective to make money off you short term.
Absolutely.
No.
And for you, Mariah, I know we had a discussion about you having your own independent music, but you're doing a lot of cover music also. Like Jimmy's saying, you have to be able to sell your product so that you can make money and reinvest that. So that's one thing I want to let you know you should really put a lot of attention and focus into. And any of you artists out there, and make sure you're selling your music.
Yes, and Mariah, if you have a big support group with your family and friends and everything, have to start coming to all your shows, merchandising, have your fans wear your t-shirts, brand yourself like Nike did, like Def Jam, Wu-Tang, everyone. You know, it's about the branding. So Mariah, you have to brand yourself before you can even take off. So when anyone says Mariah in New England, they just say Mariah, like, who, Mariah? Oh, isn't she the singer? Oh, I know, I heard about her. That's how you know you're clicking. If you say your name, you don't even have to say your last name. If you say your first name, they should already be like, oh, I know this person. I think that's her.
Exactly.
And once you get that buzz, then you get a whole team around you. You can't blow up by yourself. You have to have a team. You have to have a support group. Everyone that's supporting you, like you said, give them a position. Have one of them be your manager, have one of them be your promoter, have one of them be your social media person, have one of them be your merchandising person, have one of them be your street group, Give them jobs and then have them find people under them to push you.
Absolutely.
And that's how you're gonna get known and blown up, and use your support group. And to find the right people, do the research.
Yes.
To know who you're gonna give the music to and everything. And even if you give the music to everyone, there's like a million people that are very talented in this world, because now music and musicians and artists and singers is dime a dozen, because there's studios everywhere. Anyone can make a studio. I can record myself on a computer, take it to a studio and get it mixed and mastered.
Mm-hmm.
So it's about you and self-sustaining yourself to blow up, where someone's going to come and be like, hey, I want to work with you. Once you have an executive that says, hey, I want to work with you, you already know what time it is. If you're chasing that dream to get to an executive, to find an executive to work with you, most of the time you're going to get burnt, because you went and found them.
Yeah. Wait for them to find you. That's a very
yes.
good point.
And it's not all about business. You have to have personal relationships. It's who you know and what you know.
I absolutely agree.
You have to have both. You have to know too, because a lot of people are like, it's not what you know, it's who you know. Nah, it's like, it's who you know, but once you get to that person, you better know. Because if you don't know, they're going to be going to the person that recommended you to be like, yo, why'd you give this bozo, like Sean Price would say. Why'd you
I wanna take a date of false, baby. Yeah, bro, sexy, that's the boss, baby. Know how. how to tell me.